Morning, everyone. We'd like to sing you a song called Heaven Came Down and Glory Filled My Soul.
Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day. Day I will never forget. After I'd wandered in darkness away, Jesus, my Savior, I met. Oh, what a tender, compassionate friend. He met the need of my heart.
To move this, I'm too short for it to be above. Welcome to worship today. I'm so glad you can join us. We are going to be celebrating communion today. If you want to try the radio, it's 88 FM.
88.1.
Okay, yes, we've changed it to 88.1.
That's a legitimate station.
So the 88.1. So if you're trying to do the radio, that's a way to do the radio. It's a beautiful day, a little bit windy. The Holy Spirit's definitely with us today. We can be a little looser about getting out of the car and talking to each other with masks and so forth, or sitting outside the car. The emergency order has lifted, so that's a good start. Also, we're going to be collecting Blessing Cup again. This is the last day for Rose, so if you have any donations to give and designate to her, so you can, her family, her husband lost his job, then you can designate it Blessing Cup or Rose, and we'll be able to find it. Let us call ourselves to worship. Bless the Lord, my soul. Bless God's holy name.
Come, let us worship God who leads us into life.
Our first hymn is number 339, Be Thou My Vision.
Be Thou My Vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to thee,
meditations of our mouths and our bodies be acceptable to you. We pray in your most holy name. Amen. I invite you to read the scripture for today. As I hold the finger, you can read it to yourself or you can read it out loud to others. So let us hear the word of the Lord.
Fear, you peoples, all of you. Listen, O earth, and all that is in it. And let the Lord God be a witness against you, the Lord from his holy temple. For lo, the Lord is coming out of his place, and will come down and tread upon the high places of the earth. Then the mountains will melt under him, and the valleys will burst open like wax near the fire, like waters poured down a steep place. All this is for the transgression of Jacob and for the sins of the house of Israel. What is the transgression of Jacob? Is it not Samaria? And what is the high place of Judah? Is it not Jerusalem?
This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So usually in the summer we do a series, and we're going to be doing Micah, the minor prophet of whom we only know do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly in the count of God, right? House of God. That's all we know about Micah. We know very little about him. But Micah is a prophet who comes in the midst of turmoil to Jerusalem and Samaria. And in fact, he's one of the first prophets to cry warning. Like, we know a lot about Isaiah, but Micah was one of the first. And he's talking about the transgressions and how God is saying, look, I'm going to come down there if you don't behave, which is a pretty interesting thing because it's a long time before Jesus comes. He was one of the first to foretell that the temple would fall down. So this is Micah. And Micah is talking about, you know, that God knows what you've done and that often when things are unjust, it is in the heart of things. So in this time, we'll probably remember from Ezra, our little study last year, Samaria and Jerusalem are two high places of the Lord. And basically what happened was when the temple was destroyed, Jerusalem was one mountain, and a lot of people went back to Jerusalem. But some people stayed where they were settled before when they escaped when there was famine, and that was Samaria, right? And so there's two kind of places. And what I love about this text is he's basically saying, look, you're both in trouble. This is not about who's better. It's not about that Samaria is better than Jerusalem or Jerusalem's better than Samaria. He says, where's the heart of trouble? In Jerusalem. Oh, and where is the heart of trouble? Also Samaria, right? He's calling them all out by name. He's talking to both of them. And Micah's an interesting guy. He is one of the few prophets who never names his ancestry. He only names from where he's from. And we can pretty much figure out that that means he was not famous or well-known at all, right? If you're famous, you say, I am so-and-so, son of Jacob from the line of Abraham, right? Like, I'm from the line of Moses. I'm a big priest family, right? I'm from Aaron, whatever you do. We know that whoever you're the child of in the Bible is really important. But Micah never says who his parents are. He only identifies that he's from, a very, very, very tiny town. And so, you know, that's the first verse, which has a lot of words that are really hard to pronounce. So we didn't read the first verse because I didn't want to do that to everyone. But the first verse, if you want to look at it later, is where Micah's from, right? And he's talking about, like, God has called me out of my small town to come to the city to preach about what's going on. And one of my favorite things is that during times of injustice, right here, God promises to be closer. Right? God promises that during the time of high injustice, that God is going to be closer. And we can take it as a threat. Don't make me come down there. But it's actually a good promise, right? It's a good promise of, look, I will come down to the high places. I will come to the thin places. You know, there's that Celtic kind of idea of the liminal thin places between God and the earth. And he says, look, I'll make a thin place. I can appear anywhere. I will find a mountain to come down on. I will come and talk to you if you can't get justice going, right? And the mountains will melt, and like Max near the fire, and waters pour down this deep place. Those are pretty scary things. But for us, in a year where pretty scary things have happened, and we have some pretty big disasters going on, it's a pretty big deal. Who remembers when the Australian fires were the most remarkable event of the year? Right? Do we remember that was 2020, the Australian fires? Doesn't that feel like it was about 5 years ago? Right? That was like the first scary thing. First we had the Australian fires, right? Then the day the basketball star died, right, and the headlines, and he fell in the helicopter crash. Guess what was right next to that article? An article about a pandemic striking China, having a big deal. It was right in front of everyone's faces. How many people were paying attention to the pandemic before it came to the United States? Not me. Right? I, in my hubris, was like, I can never imagine this, all the United States getting sick. That wouldn't happen to me. But guess what? And now we have all of these marches, right? Who remembers when we thought that the Australian fires were going to be the event of the year? And then we thought, okay, maybe the pandemic is going to be the event of the year. And now last night in Washington, D.C., they had the largest, most peaceful protest that they've had in a really long time, which is a pretty big event of the year. And of course, because we're human, it's more tangled than that. It's not just one thing or another thing. They're all intertwined, right? Part of the problem with the racial injustice stuff is the people who are the most affected by the economic downturn caused by the pandemic and getting sick are brown and black people, right? The biggest disparity is there. And so it's like they were already suffering, and then the straw that broke the camel's back was that George Floyd was unjustly struck. And then we went back and we were like, oh, by the way, there was this other guy who was chased down and murdered by two men, Ahmed Aubrey. And so we started going back. And what struck me was every single city where there's a march, they said, we're also marching on behalf of this other person who's not George Floyd. Because every single person had a questionable death in their time. Now, I'm only human. It takes me a long time to see a pattern, but I'm pretty sure I finally got the pattern. And it took me this long to understand that there is this much pattern of injustice. And I think it's hard because we want to say, oh, well, that's not in the heart of the matter, right? That's just fringe elements. Right? We like to say that about everything. Like, oh, the violence is just fringe elements, or the police problems are just fringe elements. And here we don't really know what everything's going on in Samaria and Jerusalem, but Micah is saying, look, if you have this much injustice going on, the root of the problem, it has to be rooted out of the very heart of you, the very heart of your nation, whether that's Samaria or Jerusalem. And it's a pretty harsh thing, right? Like, I'd rather say, you know, not everyone is bad. Not everyone is bad. Like, I'd rather think, oh, everyone is good, right? I'd rather just look for the helpers, right? There's a disaster. Let's look for the helpers. Let's see what's going on. It's a very famous Mr. Rogers advice to children. But of course, people come back and say, but you know what Mr. Rogers says to adults? He says, go be the helpers, because the children can't see any helpers if there aren't adults going out and doing the helping. And so here's the thing. When injustice is so prevalent that we have an economic downturn and many, many, many people are in danger of losing their homes, that's not a good thing to watch as a Christian person, right? I don't think anyone should lose their home just because there's an economic downturn. I don't think that should be how it works. I think they should have enough of a safety net to do it. And when we talk about poverty, like, you know, people are like, oh, well, maybe they should save better. Maybe they can do somewhat better. As someone who's been on the edge of poverty for a long time, it's really, really hard to save extra money and do extra things. And I know if we ever lost 1 month of rent, if we ever skipped 1 month of rent when we first moved here during the recession, when there was no extra jobs to be had, we would never, ever, ever have caught up. We never would have. It never would have happened. There was no way. So it's really hard because the injustice seems so big, right? It's almost the opposite of last week when I was like, I thought one person could change the world. Sometimes when we look at global problems or racial problems or illness, it feels like one person doesn't matter, right? It feels like these are such huge problems that we can't do it. And one of the rabbis I was looking at, Rabbi Latz, said, but it does matter, and now is the time for your spiritual discipline. Now is the time for you to walk with God, because God walks especially with us when we are in the midst of injustice. And now is the time to take it to yourself to weep to God, cry to God. There's a lament section in Micah 2. And spend time with God and recharge. Because the reality is, this is the opposite of American culture. There is no quick fix to huge injustice. It's a long haul and a long job to get there. In fact, one could argue the entire Old Testament is about injustice and how the Hebrew people try to systematically learn, right, how to work against injustice and how to get it together. So when God says, you know, the Lord is coming out of his place and will come down and tread upon the high places of the earth, we can take this as a promise that God will walk with us in the long journey of injustice. And especially when we don't know what to do and we don't have the energy of what to do, it's time to take a break and spend some time with God. Your spiritual practice is more important than anything else right now, which is really hard because I feel like there's so much going on. You feel too busy for God, or you feel like this is a me thing, right? This spending time with God, this is a me thing, and it doesn't really count. It's not really helpful. But remember, our God is a gracious and just God. And when we spend time with God, we view the world in a more graceful and open presence. And we are better to understand how it is we should treat one another. Because when we don't focus on God, we get a little bit judgy. And we say, well, my way is the best way, or everyone should believe what I believe, or everyone's doing this wrong. If we just did it this way, I'm sure everything would change, right? We get in our own heads. And have you ever been stuck in your own head where the same thing keeps going over and over and over again in your head? That's why God sends prophets. Prophets are to remind us where we're going and who we should be paying attention to. So that's why right now spending time with God is more important than anything, and your spiritual discipline is more important than anything, because it gets you ready for the long haul. And it also reminds you how God views the world and gets you out of your head a little bit. And reminds you that God especially comes down in the time when injustice seems to be everywhere. And this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We are going to be celebrating communion, so if you can get your elements ready. It is my great pleasure, on behalf of Christ, to invite everyone who needs to be nourished in any way to partake in this time when God melds us together and reminds us that we are all children of God and we are all one with God. And so I am able to invite you to be fed by the Holy Spirit. And so I'm going to say, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift our hearts to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord. Dear God, it is truly right to give our thanks and praise to you who send your Holy Spirit among us, blessing these common elements so that we might taste you and see your love, so that we might swallow your grace until it overflows into our whole and entire being. I am so thankful that you are present here with us, and I pray that you send your Holy Spirit in the form of the wind today across all the elements that we have, reminding us that Jesus blessed bread and wine, the most common and humble of foods, and imbued it with his very body and his very life, so that when he died for us, we might all be forgiven, all our sins might die with him. And when he became resurrected, we all became resurrected with him, so that we can experience grace and hope and love to a different degree. Lord, I pray that you send your Spirit upon these elements here, using the prayer your Son taught us together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you to partake of your food and your cup and to be made one with the Lord. Dear God, I give thanks for whenever we have an opportunity to celebrate communion. I give thanks that you are able to share with us this time, this foretaste of the kingdom meal. And I pray that we can go forward energized and comforted by your Holy Spirit. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Our next hymn is Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. Thank you.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story.
Jesus will come.
The peace of Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Have a good day, guys. Woohoo!